The east coast of the North Island is known as a hunter's mecca, with farmlands and pine trees providing ample habitat for our huntable species. In this episode, I link up with Kurt Thomas, a farmer and keen hunter on a mission to find a particular red deer we have named the elusive Scottish 12, a stag only seen on occasion that seems to give us a fair run around. And we managed to bag a few extra treats on the way. This is East Coast station hunting at its best. I'm Toa Hunter-Gatherer. Hunting and gathering is more than a passion, it's something ingrained by my ancestors. To me, the journey of hunting doesn't end in the word hunt, it ends in the word provide. But in order to provide for my family and the community, we must first sustain the hunter. This is Hunt, Gather, Provide. Te Tairawhiti is proudly known as the first place on the New Zealand mainland to see the sun. But it does mean getting up a little earlier than the rest of the country if one wants to bag a handy animal.
We've just seen our first deer for the morning, but it's a long, long way away. Looks like a young yearling that's been booted off. This time of year, the hinds kick off their young ones as they get ready to prepare for their mating season. But this one's just a little bit too far. We're going to sidle around and check some other gullies. Let's go.
The east coast is mainly covered in Pinus radiata, which blend into the many farmlands that surround it. Old skeletons of the past remind us of a time that once was, like these pūrere logs that represent the old native forest that once towered over the fertile land. May we continue to farm in goodwill and protect what we have left.
Seen one deer so far. But I'm sure there's more out there.
We had managed to cover some ground, and Kurt gave me the heads up he had seen something. Rifle off the shoulder like a good hunter should, I caught on to what Kurt had seen. Wild pigs were introduced to New Zealand in the late 1700s as a food source, and to this day are still highly prized by hunters for kai. Our plan was to find the Scottish stag, but the farmer's rules were if you see pigs, they are priority. Pigs cause a lot of damage on farms, but on positive note, they provide a solid meal for the community.
Well, Kurt's pigs headed down the gut as it rolled down from the top of the hill there after a shot. Go recover that one. We'll get to the work of getting them back out of here.
Shot, bro.
Mean.
Yeah.
Regardless if called a pest or not, we can still be grateful for the adventure they provide us. We managed a couple more pigs that morning and gave up on chasing stags.
Beautiful way to start the day. Get home for a cup of tea before the whānau wake up. That's living.
With the bigger pig on my truck, it was only fair to give Kurt the two smaller ones. All in all, will be great chewing. Day 2, same coast, and back to the same mission of finding our stag.
A little bit of a gully, a whole mob of hinds there. They've pushed off in the direction right up into the valley. That's not really going to work for us because that'll spook every deer en route that way. So our best bet is to go back up, stop forcing the animals up the gully, and try and have a go from a different angle. So that's our plan.
We had finally made it to the top of the gully, only to be distracted by movement in one of the springs. With a bit of a sigh, we soon realised we had to put our deer hunting on hold yet again. A case of YKTR, you know the rules. Dropping the camera and getting a solid shot in myself, put another pig down for the morning.
There's another nice beautiful puaka down for this morning. We're doing a farmer a favour. And we're also providing some puaka for our local kaumātua, our elders, to get some kai before winter comes so they can stockpile for their boil-ups. So mission, third pig down. Too much, hunt go to provide.
We knew we would have spooked any deer in our vicinity this morning, so it was back home to deal to the pigs before the heat of the day set in. Although the pork was destined for other homes, it would only be good and well to put a feed on for the whānau at home. Sticky wild pork ribs, that's living. Day 3, and well, we were slightly chasing the sun this morning.
I'm just going to head up over another ridge. This is a mission of a lot of walking, but on stations you can cover a lot of ground, obviously. But it's just ahead of us. Pretty good lookout points up here.
Kurt had spotted two dark animals in the cutover. And thankfully they weren't pigs this time round. Feral goats were safe from us today.
7:30, got a good sweat on. Whew. Good training. Stay positive.
And staying positive brought in the goodness, as we spotted the stag we were after. But at 300 meters, we just needed him to stand still. Bugger. Kurt was confident at a 300 meter shot, with a decent rest, but we set off to see if we could close the gap, and we missioned into the small native gut he walked into. Things were going well, and we guessed if the stag spooked, we may get an opportunity of a shot in the open either side of the bush. Then things got exciting until we realised we were looking at a totally different stag. And with all our chatting and hesitating, the cunning 12 pointer we were after made his escape above us. With parries making a racket, we accepted defeat, and as a consolation, Kurt set up his game camera to enable us to see all the deer we didn't get. We knew the direction the Scottish stag went, but it would be a few days of work before we would return. Kurt had a few jobs for us to tick off before we could hunt again, so it made sense to give him a hand. He had the fencing sussed and had plenty of indoor work for me. Now I'm no sharer, but I've done my fair share of dagging. With a few days of work ticked off, the plan was a solo morning hunt and then meet up with Kurt for an evening mission, where we saw the stag last. But for me, I had a plan to venture the back blocks I hadn't seen yet.
Well, the plan this morning is to head down into these native guts and work my way around this whole area, this whole gully. If I can get down into the native, then I've got a bit of cover, and then that's to my advantage. I've just come down through the first gutter native, and already I've picked up on an animal right across the other side of the valley. It's approximately 300 meters away, but I'm gonna have to get out the big camera and actually zoom in and see what we're actually looking at. Check this out.
One stag turned into two, which got me keen, quick, smart.
So I've just come above the stags, approximately 200 meters above the level that I'd seen them originally from the bottom there. So my plan is now to hop back into this next native gut that they were in and then stalk down above them. I think that'll be my best advantage.
I had planned to stalk down to the stags, not talk the stags out of the bush. Just catching out a moving animal near the trees, I took the opportunity to send the lead.
Said I haven't had one that easy before. Just like that, stag down. Too much. Something powerful about how an animal can get you driven to get out there in the wild every day. As much as I love the conservation and things of this land, I also appreciate that this animal gave me the drive of pursuit to get out there and do this. I love hunting, I'm passionate about it, and these animals fulfill that drive to hunt, gather and provide. Let's get this one all cut up, packed up into pieces, and this is going to be about 3 to 4 trips for me. But might as well make a start. Let's go.
Checking out the condition of this pre-rut stag made me realise how good these station visiting animals had it with the ample tucker around them. And damn, these animals were massive. Testament to the genetic line on the East Coast. The plan was to take back all the prime cuts in my bag, and because the meat bag from the good buggers at Hunter's Element hadn't arrived yet, it was a make do with my jersey. It was a bit of a juggle as to what to take up first, but this was going to be a few trips up and down no matter what.
Woo, good blowout today. Oh man. I think this is trip number 104. Still got plenty of meat hanging up in the trees. Get home for a cup of tea. About a couple of hours away. Ha!
The electric horse was a good sight, that's for sure. Load number one done, tick.
What a bit of a bonus that was. Old Kurt, the old neighbour, he was on the fence line coming up on his bike, and I just come up to the top of the hill. I said, bro, appreciate a lift. So that's just narrowed it down to only two trips for the meat. Don't you just love it when the neighbour gives you a hand? Yeehaw! How's that for tin-ass timing?
It's pretty cool that even with all the technology around today, the true satisfaction of the day came from the simplicity of a hunter helping another hunter, sharing the load and also the adventure. With Kurt offering to drop off the meat in our chiller, I took the shortcut home.
And we're home. Yee-hee-hee.
AUV? Yeah. Definitely cup of tea time. That's us.
There is a sense of pride and also fulfillment returning home from a successful hunt.
Hey, my darling. Take that to mum.
The spoils from the land are there for those who put in the work. I could see in Kurt's eye these antlers got him keen. And I was bang on to think he'd gone out again, because that's exactly what he did. Camera in hand and wifey aboard, they set out on a self-filmed mission. And here's how it panned out. Kurt's a keen hunter who knows the station like the back of his hand, although his passion is hunting the rugged valleys of the Kawekas, but that's another adventure.
Yeah.
As for now, I think the Scottish 12 will keep him happy.
Got him. Just coming up there, a bit of a corner. Saw him up on the bank here. Something was up. Too late though. Awesome.
Hunting is a journey, and even the most simplest stag can give you the greatest adventure wherever that may be. Whether we are hunting the mighty Kawekas or the back blocks of an East Coast station, don't forget to enjoy the journey and the spoils of the land. Live a life with good people, creating good old yarns for years to come.